So today marks the anniversary of me being vegan for a year, and I know I mentioned this in another video where I talked about the book Eating Animals by Jonathan Safran Foer. But in this video, I actually do want to talk about that journey of me having been vegan for a year. It feels like it has been such a longer journey than that, but I'm really ashamed to admit that it's really only been a year since I become a vegan. And I'm gonna put a link in the description of the video of the article I've written on my associated content account. It's where I write articles, whatever kind of articles I think of, or even poems or short stories that I write. That's where a lot of it goes. And if you enjoy the article, please support me by clicking on the ad on there. You can exit out the ad. It's whatever, but you'll notice that the way freelance writers get paid on writing for website is by how many by people clicking on the ads. That's how we get paid. So if you click on an ad, you'll probably give me like what, a cent or 2 cents, but I'll appreciate that only if you like the article. If you don't, don't bother. If you read 2 paragraphs and you get bored, don't bother. That's what internet reading is like. Internet reading is a lot of skimming and kind of skipping over, and we get bored, we go to the next article, whatever. I'm very aware of the internet reading culture, even though I don't really do that. I usually tend to get sucked into an article and just read the whole thing, as long as it's not like 50 pages or something. If it's up to like 10 pages, I'll probably really read the whole thing. Maybe I'll skip a paragraph or two, but that's because my eyes get tired or something, but I'll usually read the whole thing. Now I'm digressing. So today, as I state in the article in the link, is what I consider as pretty much the most important day of my life. Really, the most important is because today is the, well, today last year is the day I consciously said that I will, choose a different lifestyle for myself. My daily actions will be different from this point on. When I made that decision, I really made it cold. I really made it without knowing anything. It was all based on conjecture and hypothetical questions. Hypothetical question as such as, well, what if we all became vegan? What would happen to the cattle industry? And that's the question that really sparked it off. Of course, the actual beginning is guilt. The actual beginning spans far back as ninth grade. I was a ninth grader. I read about certain Native American cultures and traditions, that was a time where I just, I was reading about U.S. history, and global, actually, yeah, more about global history, but I really, my personal readings was more focused on U.S. history. I read a lot of other books. I mean, I'm a history, I've been a history nut since junior high. So, beyond just my textbook, I was reading diaries of people that, diaries written by people who actually experienced the event. I hated that the textbook was always a secondary, like a narrator saying, this happened in this year. When in fact, the reality of history is that nothing is that definite. Historians will argue, did this happen in this year? Did this happen in this year? We don't know, but we have a good guess. I mean, that's the kind of controversy that was always missing in textbooks, and that's why I always went out and sought out those other sources. Anyway, so learning about these Native Americans who are so briefly mentioned in history textbooks, what, you get like one chapter, and that spans from the 2000 BC in Americas to 1400 when Christopher Columbus came. I mean, it's just one chapter, it's like 7 pages of entire Native American culture. It was just blasphemous. It was just ridiculous to me. So I always read, that was the year I started reading about that. And the one thing that really struck me about Native Americans was beyond, I mean, there's a whole bunch of things, they're the way how their societies ran with the elders. Some were true embodiment of democracy. Some were matriarchal, not patriarchal. So some actually had the power with the woman. So women did the financial, and women were the leaders of certain cultures, which is just so fascinating and so unique, especially because the Western culture and the Asian culture that I was raised out of, you know, it's most of it, most of that has been patriarchal, you know, the kings give sons as heirs. Anyway, this is also another digression. But the important thing is, what struck me the most about Native cultures was their respect and their admiration and their reverence for nature and for the animals that they shared this land with, their love of the land, and the fact that they apologize every time, maybe not every time, but they have this apologizing spirit for, to the animals, to the way they connect to the nature. That was what really always moved me. And when I learned about how they use every part of the buffalo that they hunt, down to the hooves, down to the bones, you know, grinding the bones to make glue, wearing the buffalo, you know, just to make sure that the buffalo's death was not in vain. I mean, that's just moving stuff. Like, that kind of connection to an animal always made me feel guilty. Always made me feel guilty about eating animals, about eating meat. I've never been really a big meat lover, although I have been eating meat up to last year. So, you know, but it's always something that kind of just made me think back in my mind, like, you know, I think I made a video here when I talked about my philosophy back then. You know, that was made before I turned vegan. And I also made a video about me wanting to become a vegetarian, but never making that step. Now I'm vegan, so I've actually made a step further. But that making that step, because it just made me feel always so guilty. Does my existence have to depend on the suffering and the death of another being? You know, and that always bothers me. What bothers me the most, the philosophical question that I always struggle with is, what if I was born some other way? What if I was born black? What if I was born white? The choice of our birth, the situation that we're given in birth, we don't choose it. We don't choose how we're born. We don't choose who we're born to, and we don't choose where we're born. But this is one question that we probably never considered that much. We don't choose what species we are born as. You know, I didn't choose to be human. What if I was born as a dolphin? That always bothered me. What if I was born as a cow, as a chicken, as an ant? And recently, I've actually made a bigger jump. I can't even kill insects anymore. I just can't do it. This was a humongous jump. This happened 2 weeks ago. And I know there is this such disgust of cockroaches in our culture, right? When we see cockroaches, the first reaction we have is, oh God, that's disgusting. That day, I was cleaning, I was washing dishes. There were like two cockroaches scuttling about near the dishwashing sink. And I was just like, I was about to, but I couldn't. I couldn't do it. And that was just an interesting moment that I had, that it was just like, wow, I really think my compassion, I guess you could call it, has really exceeded my expectations. A year before, I never would have expected this to happen. A year ago, I was, you know, a year and a day ago, I was in this room with a box, a box label with the logo of KFC and 8 pieces of chicken in there. I was eating it. This is the moment that struck me. I was eating it, and I was half done finishing it. As I chewed on it, the feeling of guilt in me was so strong. I felt so guilty. I had to put it down. And I kept picturing this chicken. I don't know. When I was a kid in Korea, we had two chickens. We raised two chickens, and we raised 19 chicks, 19 yellow chicks. I remember that clearly. You know, after raising the chickens, because they were too much for us. After raising chickens for 2 weeks, we gave one of the chicken to a friend of mine, and the other chicken, I think, we gave away to a farm. We kept the chicks, though. And just having that connection, seeing what the chickens were like, interacting with them, and what the chicks were like. Most of the chicks actually did run away, end up running away. Some died. I don't remember, but you know, we weren't really good at taking care of them, because it was our first time. We didn't know how to take care of animals. I don't know why we even how we got to that, or why we even decided to take care of animals. But that day, I was eating that, and I just kept thinking, I'm eating a chicken. I'm eating a chicken, like, I'm eating an animal. This thing used to be alive. What was the purpose of its death? So that I could eat it? That made me feel so guilty. That was the moment where I just was like, you know, and then I was thinking, you know, I'm thinking too much. I'm feeling too much. I'm too emotional. So, you know, I had to calm myself down. I drank some vodka, tried to calm myself down. But that was the moment it clicked. And that's when I thought, I can't do this. I can't continue with this feeling of guilt. If I was to continue eating, I don't think I'd be able to live with myself. I might as well just kill myself because I don't think I deserve life any more than this chicken does. That was my emotional state. I'm pretty sure many people probably wouldn't relate to that state. I don't know. If some of you do relate to that, then I think that's a very powerful thing. But I got to that state. I couldn't do it. And then I started thinking more about the environmental factors. So that next day is the day I said, no more. And of course, there have been some mishaps in the way. As I mentioned in the article, if you ever do get to reading it, it's a long article, so I don't expect you to. But as in the article, I mentioned that, you know, my journey as a vegan hasn't been perfect. You know, there has been some instances where I did eat animal product. You know, there's that day when I was in California. I met my mom's friend. My mom's friend was so glad to see me. She's a restaurant owner. We went to a restaurant, and to surprise me, she cooked up this humongous feast of barbecued ribs. Barbecued ribs, which is cow. And that was like 2 months or so after I became vegan. And out of courtesy, I took two pieces. So, you know, there's moments like that, you know, it's just like I didn't want to do it. And I didn't have the courage to say no. There's been a recent one like that too, where, you know, I'm at the home of a family that a student that I tutor, her mom, cooked me up this meal because she knew when I had to go, she thought I was hungry. So she made this something, it was like vegetable eggplants, but it was, the coating of the eggplant was dipped in egg. And I'm vegan, I'm not vegetarian, I don't eat anything related to animal. So that was hard, and I said, I have to go, I'm running late for the next one. She says, no, just eat it quick. There was no arguing out of that one. I was just like, okay, I really have to go? She said, you can eat it quick, yeah? And then not eating it, and then I says, and she's like, you know, but it's made out of egg, you know. It's like, I know, just this one time, you know, next time I make no more egg, no animals. And I was like, it's just like, it was so hard to get out of that situation. So yeah, I ate that. But I mean, so it hasn't been a perfect journey, but I don't expect any journeys to be perfect. And my veganism is not about being perfect, but it's really about being able to live with myself. That's really me. But I think for other people who find themselves in this situation, it's important to remember that it's not about being perfect. It's about trying our best to live our lives the way we want to live it, with our values, with things that we believe in. Our everyday actions should reflect our values. And my value is that animals deserve life just as much as we do. So I am living that value. But there are other reasons too. One of the biggest factors of me actually turning that first day, that hypothetical question was, you know, there's all this talk about cows and how their farting or their methane gas pollutes the atmosphere, kills the ozone layer, contributes to global warming. And I didn't know anything about cattle or methane gas, and this was just like totally hypothetical. I could have been totally wrong, but I'm surprised that it's not that I was wrong. It's that the issue is much more serious than what I had imagined. What I had imagined was, well, maybe the methane gas is so bad because of the fact that the cows are all gathered up in one single place, because they have to be slaughtered. So they're all gathered up in the slaughterhouses and they're all farting at the same time, and they all release the gas, all this gathered up amount of gas at the same time. So that's why the ozone layer must be horrible. So if everyone in the world became vegan, there would be no need to gather cows up all in one place. There would be no need at all. So I was thinking, okay, so everyone becomes vegetarian. No one eats meat. There will be no need for to do that. But wait. But what about the people who are not going to eat meat, who are vegetarian, but still drink milk from cows? You would still need to gather all the cows in one place to take milk out of them. Well, that must mean that vegan is the way to go in order to solve this problem. That was my hypothetical imagination. That was my on-the-minute hypothetical solution. Everyone should become vegan. It's foolish now, thinking back on that, just because it's so odd. That was my way of thinking, but that's kind of what kind of started this path. The next day is when I actually started going into other resources. So that day, what I ate was, I think I went to a halal vendor, and I asked for falafel over rice, but no white sauce, because I know white sauce is made with eggs. No white sauce, just barbecue sauce. And actually, no, I didn't even have barbecue sauce, because at the time I didn't know that barbecue sauce was vegan. So I just had rice with falafel. And I made sure to ask, falafel has no meat, right? And the guy said, yeah, no meat. I was like, okay, falafel over rice. That's what I'll have. So I paid $5 for that. And I ate that. And then I went to Subway's. And I had a veggie deluxe. That was my first day. That's how I... So veggie deluxe, I also made sure to ask all the questions. Like, you know, it's like, what is this mayo? You made it with egg? It's like, yeah, it's eggs. No mayo. This mustard. It's like, you know, and I just asked all the questions. And it was just like... And the guy was like, yeah, no. So I got a veggie sandwich. So first day, I had a veggie sandwich and falafel or rice. And then I was just like, man, if I'm really wanting serious about this, I'm gonna have to like think of recipes and stuff. And at home, like, I don't have much. So I really had no idea what to cook, no idea what to do. And that's when I started turning to vegan resources. And for a month, the way I was eating was kind of pathetic. You know, it's if there was an omnivore looking over my shoulder, you know, he would probably contemplate it, like, why are you doing this? Why are you torturing yourself? Like, why not just eat meat? What's the big deal, right? But I couldn't do it. I couldn't. I just, you know, that thought was always in the back of my mind. This is so inconvenient. There's not a restaurant I can just go into. Well, I mean, it is New York City. I could do that. But I'm in Brooklyn. And in Brooklyn, the part of my man, it's hard to find vegan restaurants, right? Like, in New York City, in Manhattan, there would be a lot. But it's just like, I can't just go into a restaurant and be like, I want this food and expect it to be vegan. It doesn't work that way. Being vegan in this society is extremely challenging, starting out as one. So I started just... I don't know. It's like, is salad all I have? That was my first question. Do I just eat salad? Of course, that's not true. It's actually, vegan diet is actually more colorful, more bountiful, and, you know, just more healthy and more various than the meat diet that I've been used to for 22 years. It's incredible what kind of life I have turned out to be. But yeah, that first month was just like, do I just eat salad? Alright, I guess I'll just eat salad. I've been able to eat just peanut butter bread and ramen noodles for 1 month one time. Maybe if I could survive that, I could survive just a salad for a month. So I did that. I discovered this thing called hummus, which I didn't know, which was vegetarian, so I was like, cool. So I got hummus, got bread. After a week, I realized that the bread I bought was made out of milk. So I was like, oh, cow milk? So I was like, oh, crap, what the heck do I do now? That's when I discovered potato bread, which is not made from milk. And then there's other kind of bread brands that I found. So, like I said, I went into this totally unknowing. I don't know, like, this was not a decision inspired by anyone. It was a decision inspired by my feeling of just humongous guilt. It was a very emotional-driven move. It was not an intellectual-based move. If it was intellectual, it probably would have taken a much more time, because I probably would have reasoned things out much more effectively. Like that whole hypothetical cock question, I mean, it's just so pathetically foolish, you know? But it's just what led me to becoming a vegan. But that first month was discovering recipes, discovering, like how can I afford vegan meals? I mean, isn't it more expensive? And, you know, me being a poor college, like, that at that point, yeah, I was still a college student. Just trying to struggle with the budget of it all. That was the biggest thing, too. It's like, isn't it more expensive to become a vegan? And I live with my budget now. And currently, the way I do it, I spend $25 a week on groceries. So my food budget is close to $100 a month as a vegan. And some days I do go out. So this is me hardly ever going out to a restaurant. Usually almost everything I eat I cook for myself. So it's the reason I do groceries, but it's not the most awesome vegan diet that I have. It's because I'm using so much less such tiny amount of money on the food that it's probably, it's not as varied as I would like to have. I'm not eating I'm not having millet, I'm not having quinoa, I'm not having tofu, I'm not having there's so many what I would consider luxurious. I mean, they're not really luxurious, but they're just a little bit more expensive than what I would have. So yeah, my budget as a vegan, I kid you not, is $100 a month. Usually on I guess if you count the high months, on average it would be about $130 a month. That's my food budget, and I don't have any kids, so this is just me. That should show you. I don't know how you would consider $130 a month, but I would personally say that's pretty damn low for a person's food budget. That's my opinion. I don't know, maybe you would think it's too expensive, but that's me as a vegan. So I'm the proof that even a person who just went pretty much cold, unknowing as a vegan, I'm the proof that vegan is affordable. It's not the fact that it's, and if unaffordability was what's stopping me, then that would have been really sad to me, because living with this guilt and then being like, oh, I can't do it because I don't have money to do it, that would have made me just so depressed. You have no idea. But luckily, it is not that expensive. Well, I mean, it kind of is, but you just have to find ways to get around it. Don't buy food that's processed. Buy whole beans. Buy a pound of beans, and rinse them in water. And as you're sleeping, let it stay like that. Wake up, it's all soaked up. Rinse out the water, and then cook the beans. Make your own stuff. It's really cheap. If you buy a week's worth of groceries every week, you save so much money. Going to a Chipotle and ordering a burrito, that's $8. Again, my groceries per week is $25. I get, if you're in California, Chipotle is going to be, what, $6? But just that difference is crazy, The amount of money that you save by cooking. But that was another challenge, too. I had a kind of upper hand in that department because my mom, 2 years prior, taught me how to cook. So I guess in that way, I was a little bit more prepared than probably many people who would just be going vegan without even knowing how to cook. I think that would be a little bit more challenging, but it's definitely doable. I think this vegan challenge, if anything, it taught me that it's really doable, this thing. It's hard. One thing that's hard is not really the diet itself. The diet itself is fine. It's actually, this is the healthiest I've ever been. I need less sleep now. I feel more energetic now. The health benefit is incredible. The amount of, I no longer have guilt as much. I'm still feeling guilty about a lot of other things. But in regards to animal issues, I don't have that much guilt. In fact, I hardly have any guilt. And that lightens up my conscience so much. That gives me so much energy to be more productive. I'm not wallowing in my guilt. I'm not being lazy in my guilt. I'm actually feel like I'm doing something every day, and that motivates me to work harder. I mean, that kind of feeling is just hard to get with a meat-based diet, I think. Where you don't think, you just eat because you're hungry. That's the meat-based diet. Me, I'm eating, and as I'm eating, I know I'm doing something that is right for me. That kind of feeling is just such a world of difference. I don't know. I think that's one part of it. But what is hard is, as I mentioned before, just being in social situations where I feel like, I still don't know anyone who is vegan in my life. Actually, I met one of the mother of the student that I tutor, her religion is Seventh-day Adventist, and her religion promotes veganism. So she actually has vegan cookbooks, and most of what she eats, she's trying hard to become a vegetarian. And so she actually even knows how to cook vegan food, too. So I guess there's some kind of social support there, but everyone else I know, not vegan, not even vegetarian. You know, being in a social situation where I'm the only vegan, I'm the vegan in the room, that's a very powerful thing. As the host of Compassionate Cooks mentions, being a vegan in the room is just such a challenging thing because they expect you to have all the answers. It's like, why do you not eat meat? Well, what about protein? What about this and that? The one thing that I really appreciated, though, it really leads to other discussions. Like when I went to Pennsylvania to my friend's home there, you know, my friend's mom learned for the first time, you know, that I'm vegan. So it's like, what? You don't eat this? You don't eat that? You don't eat that? Not even that? You know, and it was just funny. But that for a weird reason, that got her talking about suitcases and how some suitcases are made with this chemical that is cancer-causing, and how so we got all to this, like, about industrial issues, about how we should be more environmentally conscious. It just really led to so many other important issues that, and all I ever did was just sit there and I say, I don't eat that because I don't believe I should eat that. You know, that's all I ever did. And I mean, that puts you in the hot seat. If you're a vegan in the room, it just puts you in such a really, really hot seat. You really feel like, I mean, I feel like I had to represent the whole vegan community, which is insane. I've only been vegan for a year. I don't know much about it as I should. I still feel really ignorant about a lot of different things, about veganism and about animal rights issues, about animal rights history, about animal welfare issues. I've only been vegan for a year, and yet I'm placed in these situations where people expect me to become an expert. It's just really interesting how that works. So that's the challenge. The challenge is living as a vegan in a non-vegan society, in a non-vegetarian society. It's not about the food. It's about the conversations. I think that's really important. To, you know, this being vegan and in the room, it also makes me feel really empowering in a way. It encourages people in a way, indirectly maybe, as kind of maybe a role model, maybe as, man, he's so weird kind of model. In that way, it inspires people to become more aware about the things that they're doing every day and how it has an impact. I know now that at least, you know, This has a tremendous impact. Maybe I always ask myself, though, this is one question that I guess I'll end this video with because it's already 28 minutes long. I always think, well, could I actually continue this for all my life? You know, maybe I have this doubt. Maybe some point after 5 years, after 10 years, maybe I would turn back and not be vegan. What would I think then? What would be my reason for giving this up? And, you know, what would turn me away from this? And also, like what would turn me away from this is one thing. And what would I think afterwards? You know, would I think it has been a waste of time? Would I think as having been a good training exercise? Or is this thinking just completely unnecessary because I know that I can't live not being a vegan? And I don't know, that's just the kind of question I want to think about after having completed pretty much, not totally accurate, but pretty much 1 year of being vegan. And this video is how I celebrate that anniversary.